Today we're going to be talking about the four player archetypes you can design into your game. So Mike, what are those four player archetypes?
Yeah, so some people have observed that in multiplayer games, there seem to be four different ways players like to play. And originally, the people who were looking at these player archetypes were looking at a certain kind of game, multiplayer combat games, and they saw that the archetypes were achievers, explorers, socializers, and killers. Now, these archetypes were created for a certain kind of game. Some games don't have killing in them. So another way to think about these are achievers are people who are trying to play the game in the best possible way, get the highest score, maximize their playing efficiency. They like seeing the game. What's the objective of the game? I want to do that as much as possible. And explorer is not quite as interested in playing the game in the most possible way as in actually seeing the way the game works.
Or most efficient.
And these people really like mods and cheat codes and things like this, figuring out, oh, what can I do in this game? Here's another way that this can be done. This might not be the best way to win, but there are lots of different ways to play. And then a socializer is someone who likes playing with other people and cooperating and having relationships and stories and achieving things with other players. And then the killers.
Or game characters.
You might not have a game that has killing in it, but a killer is somebody who wants to compete against other players. So a socializer wants to build a Minecraft house with you, and the killer wants to burn your house down. Or to have their business have more money than your, so they're competing.
It's a competitive
against you.
Right.
They wanna dominate against you. And so you have two sort of game-based environmental ways of playing. Some people want to play the game the best possible way. Some people want to explore all the different ways to play the game and have fun sort of bending the rules of the game a little bit. Oh, I can actually do this thing that normally you wouldn't think of doing, but it's cool that I can do it. You know, they might, you might have a game that's based on the Roman Empire or on the Middle Ages, and they're like, well, you know, instead of playing as this kingdom and becoming as powerful as possible, I want to create a kingdom that shouldn't exist, but I'm going to exploit the game and make something that's silly. Socializer might say, oh, you know, I'm going to go with your kingdom and we're going to have an alliance
and make as much
resources as possible. And the killer's like, I'm going to invade your kingdom. I'm coming for everything. So whatever your game is, these four archetypes do apply because there will always be some way of because this is the way people think of the game. So if your game only appeals to one kind of person, then one quarter of the players will not have as much of an enjoyable experience with your game. So going ahead in designing a game, what you want to think about is how would these four archetypes enjoy my game? Are there opportunities for cooperation? Are there opportunities for maximizing your, which, you know, that's something that I think if you have an objective in your game, people will now be able to maximize that, but maybe make a lot of achievements in your game. Make an opportunity to have your player achieve a lot of things, make a lot of different elements that people can explore, make different ways to win the game. We have a couple other videos where we talk about things like the fact that games can be luck, strategy, or skill-based. And I think that what we will do is make a couple videos talking about each player archetype more in depth and how you can make a game appeal to explorers, how you can make a game appeal to achievers. But this is a preliminary video just to, so that you think about when you're designing your game, the fact that some people enjoy games differently. And you want your game to be fun for everybody, and you can put elements in your game that will appeal to everybody.
Well, I think that's the biggest key, especially when we help companies and teams design and develop their games and work on their lore, their writing. Everybody's got a great idea. Everybody knows what they envision, how they would want to play the game. But again, we have to think about the archetypes, the types of players that you want to attract. If you're simply going for an exploration-based game, then that will also affect your marketing, knowing that you're only going after this type and certain player. So again, working from that endpoint back and saying, well, if we're just designing it to be a game that's based on achievements, then players that don't necessarily just intrinsically enjoy that play style might not be attracted to your game. So why would you spend your marketing dollars there? From a business perspective, we're thinking about how to build the community and what that community is going to look like. Now, of course, if you want to a mass-produced game that has mass appeal, you're going to want to look at how your game engages with those four types. Because you will have players for any concept, just in a human perspective, have a certain playthrough that they like with one of those four aspects.
Yeah, you know, I see a lot of games, obviously now we're in a world where we have lots of open world games where there's so many different elements of the game, but there are a lot of games that are open world games that still have a high score. Minecraft has a high score.
Sure.
There are, you know, achievements are very popular, and having ways for players to compete and cooperate with each other.
Right.
In a game like Minecraft, you can build, you can try to get more achievements, you can try to get as many diamonds as possible, you can go and there are combat elements. Yeah. So in a lot of games, they'll have a lot of different elements. But even in a game that's more narrow and focused, there can still be, even in a first-person shooter where, well, you have got a gun, you got to shoot, but you can be on a team with somebody, and then you can try to kill the other team. You can try to, if you're playing a game like Halo, you can try to pick the best possible strategy, kill as many aliens as possible, or you can say, hey, we're going to go over here and try to defend this bridge, or we're going to go over here. And people will role play, and they're going to say, well, you know, I'm only going to play with a pistol, because, you know, and they put their own restriction, and that's an explorer. They're not trying necessarily to achieve the highest number. Right. They're saying,
how would the game function with these
I'm playing the game in this way. I'm exploring the features of the game. You know, maybe I'm going to try to shoot a bullet and ricochet it off something, you know. So even in a game with very narrow focus, you can still have in your mind, let's try to put in elements that will appeal to all four different kind of player archetypes.
I think as we kind of wrap up this specific topic, and we'll go more into this, I really think that a great game thinks about its almost its subtitle of what it's trying to get the players to engage in and how. In the sense of, you mentioned Halo, Halo became probably one of the greatest multiplayer games of all time. But its subtitle that a lot of people forget from Halo 1 is Combat Evolved. So they were trying to figure out how to deliver something to a player where they were enhancing this multiplayer combat experience that had never been done in gaming before. And I think that that is a critical, because a lot of times, you know, before that, gaming was either, you know, I think probably the only multiplayer game might have been Street Fighter, where you were only playing against another player at that point. But in the Xbox, PlayStation world, a lot of games were only, you play as a single player, you play through the missions. And, you know, like we mentioned, like Galaga or Pac-Man, you're playing against kind of a coded system. But you're not really playing with someone else. Or at that point, you were playing against someone else. The most original example is Pong in the 70s, right? So I think, again, working from that endpoint and thinking about what you want your players to feel and do in your game, if you're trying to advance something like combat,
and also
that's not, what you code
it. But not forcing the player in a way, trying to figure out what they want to do and delivering that.
Yes, exactly. Well, thank you so much for tuning in. Remember to subscribe and share our videos. Until next time.